Future historians are going to look back and they will say a small and courageous band of Teamsters, realizing that there was something infinitely more important than their own jobs, that the future of American wages, full-time work for full-time people, through the line in 1994 in Columbus, Ohio, and other places, through the line!
North America, you see us on the job. From Atlanta to Calgary, Vancouver to Cape Cod. You can't tell us by our color, you can't tell us by our hat. We're the backbone of our country, we take pride in being that. We're brothers and we're sisters, working hard for what is fair. You can always tell a Teamster by that certain pride he wears. Meeting all the challenges, united we stand tall. Proud to be a Teamster, that's why we'll never fall. Giving them the melody, the song that's not been sung. In a moment of reflection, I close my eyes and see the dreams our fathers had for us are now reality. We're brothers and we're sisters, working hard for what is fair. You can always tell a Teamster by that certain pride he wears. Meeting all the challenges, united we stand tall. Proud to be a Teamster, that's why we'll never fall. We're brothers and we're sisters, working hard for what is fair. You can always tell a Teamster by that certain pride he wears. Meeting all the challenges, united we stand tall. I'm proud to be a Teamster, that's why we'll never fall.
Everyone, if you're expecting a package to be delivered UPS, don't expect it anytime soon.
That's because United Parcel Service workers in Central Ohio are holding picket signs today.
We have some live pictures for you from the UPS Center on the west side. Teamsters union members there walked off the job at 8 o'clock after the company raised the weight limit on packages to 150 pounds.
Workers say that's too much and that too many of them could be hurt trying to lift that much. Jane Yamamoto is there live this noon. Jane, how many people are on strike here in Columbus?
Robin and Joel, nearly 100% of UPS package car drivers from Local 413 are out here protesting in front of the hub right here in Columbus. And they say this is the site of six UPS centers. That is where six of the UPS centers are based. Nearly 150 drivers who normally deliver to the north-northwest section of the city are out here. And they say that that this is a health and safety issue.
The injury rate, speaking just from my center right now, is we're always running short-handed now as it is, because there's people off on injury, therefore we all have to work 10, 12-hour days.
What kind of injuries?
Back injuries, leg injuries, arm injuries, shoulder injuries. I mean, no matter how safe you work, and no matter how you lift the packages, I mean, you're going to get injured eventually.
150 pounds, I weigh 140 pounds myself. Can you imagine me lifting a 150 pound box? I mean, I hurt myself lifting a 50 pound box a year ago. 150 pounds would probably just blow me away.
And the person you just heard from is Derek Cox. He is a UPS package car driver who received a hernia about a year ago. He had surgery, and he says just last week the hernia recurred due to lifting heavy boxes. Now, UPS package car drivers say the company is not equipped to handle 150-pound freight, and they say they just want the company to implement some sort of a new job classification to handle this heavy cargo.
Good evening, everyone. There are calls denied by Ohio Teamster leader officials to end the strike, but UPS workers are on strike here in central Ohio, hundreds of them, and your packages are very likely to be delayed.
All across the country tonight, there are scattered strikes over a weight limit change in the packages they handle. This is the strike in Atlanta, and United Parcel Service workers are on strike in Louisville, Kentucky, among other cities.
The weight limit on packages is being increased from 70 to 150 pounds, and the strikers say that's too much for one worker to lift. Someone could get hurt.
Workers in the brown UPS truck pulled out of the building this morning, only to be met with harsh words from striking drivers. Nearly all of the regular UPS drivers who deliver packages in the northern part of the city were on the picket line this morning. They gathered to protest the company's increase in weight of packages they will ship from 70 to 150 pounds. The striking drivers say an increase in package weight will lead to even more work-related injuries. Greg Sopp says he knows all too well what the heavy packages can do to his back.
Back in 1990, I had back surgery, and I lifted a package that was marked 65 pounds, and it weighed over 109 on the top shelf of my truck. And I ended up with a ruptured disc, and eventually, months later, I had to have major back surgery.
And striking workers say this is a health and safety issue. They say it is not about money, but many of them claim the company raised its package weight for business purposes.
Evening. If you're waiting for a package to arrive by UPS, the wait may be longer than you think.
Columbus UPS workers are on strike tonight. United Parcel Service Teamsters Union members from Local 413 walked off the job at 8 o'clock this morning, and you can see some are still picketing tonight. About 130 UPS drivers in Columbus are protesting the company's decision to raise its weight limits on packages from 70 pounds to 150 pounds. News 4's Jane Yamamoto is live at the UPS warehouse on the west side. Jane, I certainly can understand, from my point of view anyway, lifting a package 150 pounds is pretty heavy.
It is pretty heavy indeed. And right now, UPS workers from Local 413 still out here doing whatever they can to stay warm and holding their signs up, as you can see, their signs of strike. Nearly all of the regular UPS drivers who deliver packages on the northern part of the city were on the picket lines this morning. They gathered to protest the company's increase in the weight of packages they will ship from 70 to 150 pounds. Columbus UPS workers deliver on average about 120,000 packages, and many of the employees here say this strike could have a huge impact on local businesses.
Well, I wouldn't want to put any percentage on it, but we'll definitely feel it. Definitely feel it.
Norm Sherson says the Sleep World stores receive three daily deliveries from UPS, most of which are special orders from New York, Tennessee, and Chicago.
We receive special order things like futon covers, futon pads at times, sometimes futon frames themselves, and this is important to us. People order them, and they like to get them right away.
Good evening, everyone. If you're expecting a delivery from United Parcel Service and have not received it yet, it may now be a while.
Nearly 150 UPS drivers have walked off the job here in Central Ohio. UPS Teamsters Union members have been on the picket line since about 8 o'clock this morning. This came after the company raised the weight limit on packages from 70 to 150 pounds. Striking workers say it's a health and safety issue that 150 pounds is just too heavy.
The walkout could mean big trouble for businesses that rely heavily on the package delivery service.
How about an on-camera debate?
I'm not going to debate with you.
Why not? I'll debate with you.
I'm not going to debate
with you. It's wrong, ground. You're not.
So anybody that wants a message...
Tempers flare on the picket line today as UPS workers in Columbus and all over the country walk off the job. Good afternoon. I'm Jeannie Catherall.
And I'm Bob Hetherington. The big story this noon, UPS drivers on strike. Teamsters union members are picketing right now, protesting a change in policy that more than doubles the maximum weight a package can be. How does all of this affect your delivery? Sandy Heng has been at the UPS plant all morning. She joins us now live. Sandy.
Bob, for the most part, it has been a peaceful strike here at the West Columbus headquarters of UPS. At issue, some workers do not want to carry the 150-pound packages that the company is proposing.
We feel 150 pounds is too much for a company to ask one person to handle and packages and to deliver and to load.
If this thing goes into effect, God only knows what we're going to end up with. This is an imminent danger hazard, which has prompted the international to take this action, and we're in full support of it.
While Columbus workers are protesting behind us, in Washington, D.C., both company officials and union leaders are negotiating at this hour.
Here's a map showing just where UPS workers are striking. In Augusta, Georgia, right here in Columbus, in Pittsburgh, Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Atlanta. In Atlanta, striking workers shouted at and harassed other drivers as they headed off for deliveries this morning. There was no violence, only angry words. Well, hundreds of UPS workers are off the job at issue. They don't want to handle 150-pound packages, and the company wants them to.
A federal judge ordered employees to stay on the job for another 5 days, but striking employees felt they had to take action before someone got hurt on the job.
This 150-pound weight limit is totally off point. The foundry industry in this country has attempted to use two-man lifts of 150 pounds, and they've run into problems with OSHA.
Right here, the union people say that they're going to be here all night until this is resolved. They want negotiations to go forward. I don't know if you can see beside me here that they have started a fire to keep warm because they say it may be a long camp out. Bob?
Managed to read this restraining order issued by a U.S. federal judge.
Employees and managers clash as hundreds of UPS workers ignore a court injunction and walk the picket line. Hello, I'm Tom Lawrence.
And I'm Deborah Countess. The big story, UPS workers walk off the job and onto the picket line today. The issue, they don't want to carry the 150-pound packages the company is proposing.
Columbus police escorted UPS managers to the line to listen to the union leaders. Both sides refuse to budge and are waiting on the outcome of company union negotiations in Washington, D.C.
And Teamsters on the line tonight say they're going to be waiting here all night long and tomorrow and the next day until something is resolved. Because the 150-pound weight limit.
That's unreasonable?
Yes, I would do. Like 30 pounds more than what I weigh.
Well, if you are expecting a package from UPS today, we do have some bad news for you. Good afternoon, everyone, on this Monday. I'm Andrea Camber.
And I'm Jerry Revish. The tightest ship in the shipping business is dead in the water today, the victim of a labor dispute with the Teamsters Union. Workers at this UPS plant on Alum Creek Drive walked off the job at 8 o'clock this morning, despite a court order banning a strike. Workers this noon are out all across the East, and those involved say it will last until the company agrees to work out a safe way to handle 150-pound packages. So what happens if you want to send a package out today? Let's go live to Lorene Wagner, who's at a UPS terminal on Trayview Road on the west side. Lorene?
Jerry, I want to let you know, first of all, this UPS location is open for business, but the real activity is outside. We've got strikers and cars lined up. Now, inside, people are attempting to mail packages. but no trucks are going out. The company is trying to work out a backup plan to get deliveries back on track. Police have been standing by at both Columbus locations. So far, it has been a very peaceful strike. Workers simply don't think it's safe to lift 150-pound packages. The company says they're just trying to stay competitive in a changing market. Workers want to let you know they're sorry if they can't get your packages out today, but they're not going back in until the company makes some changes.
We apologize to the public, but this is something that they got to stand behind us on also, because after all, these people work for a living. They have children, they have lives.
And at this hour, the people out here still have jobs. The company tells us, despite the court order preventing them from doing this, they're not going to take any disciplinary action. So everybody has jobs as of right now. Jerry.
Hope they can work all that out, Larry. Well, the lights may be out tonight at UPS as the company tries to rebound from a nationwide strike. In Ohio, workers hit the picket lines in Columbus and Chillicothe today. Union employees say they will not go back to work until the company puts new safety measures in place. Today, the company upped its weight limit from 70 to 150 pounds per package.
I think it's crazy. I think it's absolutely crazy. On a good day, with the equipment they have, I was lucky to get a two-wheeler before I left the building to get the package, the 70-pound packages, off my truck.
If you refuse to leave now, you can be arrested.
Are you saying you're going to arrest me?
I'm going to arrest you, but...
Police kept watch at the two UPS locations in Columbus. So far, no report of any trouble.
And something that did not last very long, that national walkout by 90,000 United Parcel Service Teamsters.
UPS management this evening reached an agreement with the general president of the Teamsters Union.
Union members from Local 413 had walked off the job at 8 this morning protesting the company's decision to raise its weight limit on packages from 70 to 150 pounds. They thought somebody was going to get hurt.
And Rich Skidmore was on the picket line when the agreement was announced. He's joining us live now from the newsroom. And Rich, did the strikers get what they were asking for?
Well, sort of, Colleen. That 150-pound weight limit still exists. But for the first time, UPS management has agreed to negotiate ways to handle those packages and to provide ways to keep workers safe in the meantime. Now, we were the only news crew on the picket line tonight when union leaders announced the agreement, and as you might imagine, union members seem pleased with it, and they're especially pleased to be returning to work.
That no bargaining unit member will be required to handle any package over 70 pounds in weight without the assistance of another bargaining unit employee. Yeah!
It's something they thought they'd never hear. New rules for handling packages, while permanent rules can be hashed out at the bargaining table. The agreement to call off the walkout calls for immediate good faith bargaining over terms to handle the packages over 70 pounds. In the meantime, no UPS Teamster is required to handle such a package without assistance from another Teamster, and lifting devices will be provided. Also, UPS customers will be required to label the over 70-pound packages, and no bargaining unit member will be subject to discipline for the walkout. The agreement isn't all the Teamsters wanted, but they say it's a move in the right direction.
We've got a long way to go to make this thing work. The technology's going to have to change, but it looks like we've got a good start on this.
So it's back to work on the next shift with a feeling they went to bat on safety issues and are still in the ballgame.
The way they wanted us to do those packages wouldn't work, and we've tried to tell them that, and that's what we did today. We told them it's not going to work the way you want to do it, and we want to provide you with better ways and different ways of doing it.
There was never an idea we wanted to quit this company and leave or get fired. We just want a safe working environment, and hopefully we can get the customers' packages to them on time now.
Hi, it's Bob Trakis here with the Free Press Forum. We're on the picket line with the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, and you can see what you haven't seen in a while, a little working class solidarity, which is exactly what's needed in this era of union busters.
Right on, brother.
The greed heads. What we've had is this period of time where everyone's been rewarded. People who've looted the SNLs, took a lot of money, people who've destroyed the union, and of course in NAFTA, these Mexican fast trackers who've taken these jobs overseas. So people are fed up and they're taking a stand here. They're fighting for their livelihood, and we're interviewing some of the Teamsters here today. What's going on? How's any action on the line today?
Yeah, we had 10 people arrested. We were forming lines.
to keep trucks from coming in and out, doing our job. The whole point, the whole reason we're here is for the future of America. We're in support of not part-time work. We want people to get a full-time job with full scale. Right now, part-time people make $14 an hour. They want to decrease that to $8.50 an hour. We run about 10% of our freight on rails. They want to up that to 35%, and we feel that's unfair. We'll have drivers lose their jobs over that. And we're just working-class people. We believe in America. We believe in standing up for our rights. We believe in coming out here in peaceful protest of unfair labor negotiations, and we're going to stand together, and we're getting, I'd say, 90% public support of people driving by who we yell working class to, that built this country, and we're going to stick together, and we're going to make them compromise, and we want to compromise because we do want to go back to work.
But what's it feel like when a scab crosses the picket line, when someone comes up here and tries
to... armed robbery to your family, like somebody comes in your house and takes food out of your baby's mouth. That's exactly what it feels
like. Right on.
Yeah,
getting stolen from.
We don't want to be here. We'd rather be working. But if they want to cut those wages and put all our freight on rails and put our drivers out of work, we got to stand up for something.
I mean, we're standing up for the other people. That's what it's about. You know, they say they'll protect us, but from now on, they want 25% of the workforce at part-time, $8.50 an hour. I got a wife, 3 kids, a mortgage. I couldn't pay my mortgage on $8.50 an hour. They want to guarantee them 3 hours a day working.
And they want you to compete with Mexican truckers who will move someone across country for $2,000.
Sure.
Right.
Well, they don't have to have the requirements our drivers have to have.
They have to be certified in Mexico. You know that's good certification.
Yeah. Really.
Their equipment ain't as safe as ours.
That's right. Well, they have to check, make sure that the air brakes have been taped a little.
Yeah. And if they get these 850 people in here, they're going to eventually phase us right on.
Corporate America is already, all the businesses across the country is already full part-time just about. This is one of the last strongholds of good American jobs, and we want to keep them. We're not willing to give them up.
Well, here's an interesting thing viewers might not know on this show, that the largest employer in the U.S. last year was Manpower, Inc., in the so-called rewarding field of temporary work. By the year 2000, it's projected, if these trends aren't stopped, half of all Americans are going to be working part-time. Real wages have not increased in the United States since 1973. And back then, 40% of married couples had to work two jobs. Now it's 60%. So now you've got two people working to make what one person used to make 20 years ago. And I'll tell you who's benefiting. The top 1% of the population, their income went up 2,184% in the last 12 years, while average working class people have had to work longer and harder just to stay even. So what you're seeing here, I think, is going to be the first of many strikes where people want decent wages, full-time wages, and full-time work. And you're seeing that being played out here in Columbus, Ohio, the birthplace of the AFL-CIO.
Yeah, right on. We'll be out here standing together as long as we have to do it.
Thank you.
Sure.
We don't get a break like that
from the other people reporting
stories. That's why I asked you from the dispatch. We're going to tell you, take it on down the road.
These people that come in here do not give the story. Because they're bought and sold anyway. They're not a labor paper.
No, and I tell you what, they'll tell you that there's things like big labor. U.S. has the lowest amount of people in labor unions of any democracy, only 16% declining. I mean, all this stuff, as you know, first they busted PACO during the Reagan era, and everything's been bust unions, drive people's jobs down. And then the people at the top, what we do have is the highest paid CEOs in the world. They're making twice as much as their Japanese counterpart, and all they want to say is that working people make too much money. And that I think there's like a lot of hostility built up, and this is just the tip of the iceberg.
Well, right here, the guy named Moffitt, right here, just for CF Incorporated himself, he doubled his salary to, what is it, million?
$1.7 million
a year. And his justification for that was on a tape that they sent to us by Lawrence here at CF, was that he cut middle management. So he's spitting in their faces also. He cut their jobs and starved their families to double his salary. It's just not right.
It's not right.
Okay, you heard it. And again, we'll check some other sites, and you can see very strong solidarity. And again, this is one of the strongest unions you'll see, the International Brotherhood of Teamsters.
Brothers.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Member Hoffman.
Thank you.
That's it. Member Hoffman.
today.
All right, go ahead.
Hi, Bob Fitragas with the Columbus Free Press. We're here at the picket line, and we're talking to an individual who seemed to have a run-in with a scab. We'll see if we can get the inside story on that. What happened?
Well, a rider rental truck had been stopped and asked to honor our picket line yesterday, and he left, and then he came back a few minutes later and pushed his way through. And we asked him again to nicely not to cross our picket line. He started accelerating, speeding up, running over people, knocking them out of the way with the bumper. And apparently, I got knocked down by the side of the truck, and he ran over my foot with the drive tires.
Okay, now, what was the company's version? That you viciously attacked the van, hurled yourself into it?
Yeah, the company made a statement all to the news media that I had jumped on the truck and that I fell off and I was okay.
Okay.
I have three broken bones in the foot, and it's kind of hard to fake broken bones, so I would say, that I was injured.
So you weren't an actor in your previous work life?
No, no.
Okay, what's this strike about? Why would
we're against the company's proposal that they want to use more rail, use independent drivers, brokers to haul our freight. They're wanting to use part-time workers at a lower hourly rate. If they do this, if we let them get by with this one, then we're going to wind up and all that we won't have a job that we've had and all for all these years to for our families. We won't have anything for the future if we let them get by with what they're doing right now.
Okay, you heard it again, the question of whether people have full-time work at a decent wage or whether the tendency to push the wages of working people down will continue in this country. Again, the Labor Department predicts half of all American workers will be part-time by the year 2000 unless the Teamsters and other unions can prevail and win this strike for full-time work at a decent wage. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
The top jobs, you want to bring $9 an hour part-timers into this company, and yellow and roadway, and double-breasted. They have CCX, which is
double-breasting, you mean having non-union people?
Another company that hauls our freight, too, and they keep saying all the time that they don't, that it will not interfere with this, but the way they're going right now is that it's not good for us.
And how long you been driving?
I've been in the union for 42 years. I've been with CF 25.
25 years, so.
Yeah.
And things been getting worse, getting better?
Last 25 years, just went downhill.
Yeah.
It's basically the last 10 years.
Okay.
Ever since deregulation and ever since the government, ever since President Reagan fired the airline controllers.
Well, when he went after Patco.
Right.
So,
right there.
So you see, this is sort of a stand that might turn things about. There really hasn't been any militant strikes in a long time.
This is like the old times.
Okay, actually, you might even get a labor movement again, huh?
I hope.
Okay.
These young people need a labor movement.
They don't remember what it's like.
Yeah. They don't really realize what's going down in this country today.
Yeah. No, it's like
look at your young kids that's working out here today. That's coming out of high school at $5 an hour jobs.
$4.25 minimum wage,
yeah.
No benefits.
They talk about hospitalization. Our president right now wants a medical program for everybody in this country.
Yeah.
Well, at one time we had one. Every union in this country had everything organized. Everybody had a medical program. Hospitalization. You take AT&T, you take Kroger and company, all your big chains and all that. At one time it was all union. Today, everybody going to work in them places will never make the money that people spend with 15 years with. And Consolidated Freightways, Yellow Roadway, and all these, they want to do the same. They want a $9 an hour job here. And
don't they also want you to compete with Mexican labor?
Oh, not here. They have, no, that's
down
not.
Down on the border?
Oh,
in the
South. We're not supposed to have that. It's not supposed to happen. The President of the United States says it wouldn't happen, right?
But they're certified, all their rolling stock certified in Mexico.
Right, right.
So we can trust that.
Right. We've, you know, it's got to change. And the young people's got to fight.
Well, maybe this might be the first step in a changing attitude.
I hope.
So you feel you've been driven to this? You wouldn't be out here by choice, right?
I'm ready to retire.
Right.
But I can't let walk off and leave what I've had to nothing.
Right.
These young men's got to have a job, too. And I want them to have the same thing I had. I can buy anything. I want a new car. I can buy it. A new house. I can buy it. Man, I made a good living. It's good.
So is this what solidarity means? People out here together,
right,
willing to put their jobs on the line?
Yes.
I tell you what,
good talking to you.
Paul, it's like 800.
I just two of them.
Let's get up close. LA, you're going to run over.
There's the agitation.
Talk to him, but nobody's doing it.
Get him close. Zoom in out. All right.
Oh, yeah. He's coming out here with another guy.
Who's the union steward? Is that one here today?
I'm a business agent.
I'm sorry?
I'm a business agent.
Lieutenant Mann, we've got a modified order that I have to post. I'll give you a copy of it in hand. I'll post two. This is Deputy Master Sergeant Brown.
Videos for that we've read.
Would you like me to go over here with all your people and let them all hear?
Yeah.
Okay.
Make sure you get this on video.
What's the
other one? Okay, gentlemen. We've got a modified order from the Judge Kelly.
Duty Judge.
Put him in there, brother.
Put him in there, guys.
Consolidated Freightways Corporation of Delaware, doing business as Consolidated CFO. Plaintiff versus International Brotherhood of Teamsters, Local Union 413, AFL-CIO.
That judge don't care about us. He's retired. He ain't running for no office. He's a son. Gilly is an ass. Gilly is. He ain't running for no office, and he's non-union. He's
Oh, that's good. It's a damn good thing he ain't running, because nobody
in the industry
runs back in. We refuse to go back.
What about parking on the west side? It doesn't say anything about parking, but I would say that. Now put it on your sign.
Down below us.
Down below it. Right there.
There, you want to stick there. That'll hold her.
If it blows off, we can't do nothing with it.
That's it.
All right. If it's not there, we can't comply with something that ain't supposed to.
Welcome back to Newsmakers. Charles Tease joins us now. He's Secretary Treasurer of Teamsters Local 413. And as you know, we've been doing a lot of stories about the strike. We have some video to show you. We do have people on picket lines. They have been striking for several reasons. We caught 413 pickets on the picket line day and night. And also to bring some public attention and to get their story out, there was also a rally held on the State House steps last week. We're taping this on Friday morning for airing. You're seeing it on Sunday. There were speakers. There was a hookup with the national president where there were speakers hooked up. And you had a lot of attendance, and you have a lot of people out there interested and concerned. But let's get right to the bottom line, Mr. Tease. Why the strike? A strike is never an easy thing to decide to do.
No, it's not. And this is the first strike we've had in 15 years in the freight sector of the trucking industry that's unionized. The reason for the strike is the employers' association put a proposal on the table, said take it or leave it, where they wanted to put in at least 25% part-time people during the life of this contract. And we just don't want to give away good full-time, good-paying jobs in the heavy industry and commerce of this country to part-time.
Obviously, it's a big issue because people are not working. And in fact, there was a company, Churchill, that did shut down, but I'm told that that's bad past management and nothing to do particularly with the strike.
Yes, Churchill had already been teetering on insolvency. They had to go to their employees, our members, and get a 9% reduction in wages. Our members gave that to them so they could survive. Unfortunately, that still didn't do it, like has happened in so many other less than truckload freight carriers, regional carriers mainly, over the last 10 years.
There is bright news on the horizon. There are talks scheduled. Tell me what the plans are.
Well, yesterday we got a message from Mariner National Union saying that the Trucking Management Incorporated, the bargaining association for all the unionized carriers, had agreed to go back to the bargaining table. That will happen Monday in Washington. So we hope we can have a quick resolution of this strike. And we hope that the employers will see the wisdom in getting off of the part-time issue, and that I think will end the strike.
Are you going back behind the wheel during the talks?
No, the strike will continue while the talks are going on Monday. Hopefully those talks will be successful and it won't go on too much longer.
Can we talk about what the give and take could possibly be? I'm told there are 1 in 5 are already part-time, and it was going toward 25%. Can the truckers afford to give in? Can the union afford to give up anything?
I don't believe we'll give in on the part-time issue. They already have casual employees. They only have to pay 6 hours a day if they wish. They make a lot of hay out of the UPS agreement that they've got 25% part-time. But when that was implemented, it was in the 1960s. When UPS was a small package carrier, they only had a 50-pound limit on their packages. And granted, they've increased that threefold since deregulation of the trucking industry, which has brought most of these problems on. You really can't equate the two.
Part of the problem that I understand with the part-time is, of course, wages would be less, but also the health benefits, the welfare benefits, and also I know safety considerations are in there as part of this package. When there are part-time employees, the employers don't have to pay as much as far as benefits are concerned.
No, they were proposing $9 an hour, which would be just about half of what they pay the full-time employees presently in the freight industry. They wanted a lower tier health, welfare, and pension package that the company would control. And we don't think that really bodes too well with the members. UPS does cover their part-time people with health and welfare insurance and pension coverage. But freight, I don't believe there's room for part-time employment in there like there's been in UPS since the 1960s.
There are people who say no job is secure, nobody can be sure, and may not be as sympathetic as you would like. What kind of reaction are you getting from the public and from others in allied industries?
I think we're getting a very good reaction from the public. I think the public in this country realize, and the theme of President Clinton's campaign was, we need good paying jobs in this country people can earn a living, raise a family, put their kids through college. We don't need part-time jobs in a part-time economy. I mean, the heavy industry and commerce of this country can't be moved by the kind of employees that we have in the service sector, like the fast food chains. It just won't work. Part-time America just won't work.
You are confident, hopeful. What's the right word as far as the talks are concerned?
We're hopeful that the employers will see the wisdom in continuing to provide full-time jobs for our members in the heavy industry and commerce of this country.
We have run out of time. We will certainly be doing more stories with you, and we certainly hope that this all works out.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks for joining me today on Newsmakers. And thank you for watching. Have a beautiful Sunday.
Consolidated Freightway is here, and he's going to tell you how they ran over him because he was fighting for his family. Mike.
I am a proud Teamster member, like my dad. like my dad in the 40s and the 50s to fight for what we believe in. I have one question to ask the companies. Why not get back to the table? Teamsters are striking to protect their livelihood, to protect full-time work, and the companies won't even talk to us.
Back to the table!
No. Back to the table!
Back to the table!
Back to the table!
He insisted on coming through the line. He started speeding up, knocking other drivers out of the way, other strikers out of the way. In turn, I got knocked down to the ground. My foot was run over. I got three broken bones in my foot. As soon as I got out of the hospital, I went back to the strike line, up to the front. I asked the company, is it worth it? Is it worth getting people hurt for? Is it worth hurting families just to make a few extra bucks to move your freight? CF and the TMI need to get back to the table. They need to talk to our leaders. Teamsters stand strong and united. We are prepared to stay strong. We are prepared to negotiate. Let them hear us out at Alum Creek, Fisher Road, and 104. TMI, let's get back to the bargaining table. Let us get back to work and do our job.
Listen, we got one more speaker that's run for Congress, and he wants to speak to the crowd. His name's Bob Petrakis. While we're waiting on Kerry to get the audio link, we're going to let Bob Petrakis talk a little bit.
Thank you. I'm a doctor of political science over at Columbus State. Right. Oh, okay. Let me tell you the reason I have a doctorate today, because my dad was a Teamster sanitation worker, and he supported doing now. Let's look at this. Who gets rewarded in this society? You work 70 hours a week and they reward those who loot the SNL. They reward those who take jobs down to Mexico and take work away from American workers. What they are doing is building inequity, injustice, and exploitation into this contract, and you're drawing a line. You're saying no. It's fitting that this strike occurred the week after Easter, because they thought you would fold. They thought you would take the 30 pieces of silver and sell your brothers and sisters down the road. Right now, the largest employer in the United States, Manpower Inc., in the so-called rewarding field of temporary employment. By the year 2000, they project half of all American workers will work part-time. Future historians, I have a PhD in political science. Let me tell you, future historians are going to look back and they will say, a small and courageous band of Teamsters, realizing that there was something infinitely more important than their own jobs, that the future of American wages, full-time work for full-time people, drew the line in 1994 in Columbus, Ohio, and other places, drew the line! These are all
fellows here. This is why, when you go back out there on those strike lines, we're seeing a lot of the same. Okay? We need you back out there. We're seeing a lot of faces, the same faces. If these guys are not walking this picket line, call them.
Yeah.
Tell them this is the final stand that we're going to take. Don't they understand that the Big Four is trying to drive these small companies out of business?
Absolutely.
And they're going to try to take it all over with their non-union scam.
Absolutely.
So we've got to get back and get these guys out here on the strike line. That's the only way we're going to win it.
Right.
And we have your wives and anybody to call these bums over here. Son of a bitch, get your ass out here! Get out here! Get out here, you punk! Get out here!
Teamsters together!
Jobs for the future. I got some extra buttons for anybody who want it. We've used your picket line. We showed up, and we're using our picture to help rally our members.
All right.
Give me a couple of for these young kids up here.
Henry!
Union together!
You!
Union together!
Give me another one.
I want to thank the Teamsters. I think they're bringing the issue right out the front. The issue is jobs for the future, and we don't have it unless we stand up for it.
Right.
I'm proud to say that the Teamsters are leading this movement, and I'm glad, proud to say that I that we will follow, and that the future is ours when we do stand up. Thank you.
I didn't come up here prepared to say anything, but once I got here, I kind of felt maybe I should. I've got a boy here. He's 15 months old. I did not start my family until I had a union job and could support my family. All the other jobs I had before, I could not support my family. So I did not get married. I did not have a family. Now, what am I supposed to do now?
Fight!
I'm gonna fight!
Fight!
I'm sick of it! They're trying to ruin America!
Absolutely!
What am I gonna do? Work 3 hours and support my son and family?
No.
I can't do it!
No
more time!
No
more time!
My phone hookup, but because it didn't work with President Kerry, it's not going to work with Joel either. But we wanted you to know that he wanted us to send a strong message of support to you, the striking Teamsters, and to ask for your support, as you know he's running for the United States Senate.
Our attorneys in Local 413 did a great job for us during this strike so far, and we want to invite Bob Handelman up to say a couple of words. Bob, come on.
Let me take this opportunity to tell you guys that in the 20 years that I've practiced law, I've had few opportunities to represent people who showed the courage and the commitment and the integrity that you guys have on these picket lines. This union has made it real clear that what we want is the future. We know we had a past. We know we are the second or third or fourth generation of Teamsters who've been able to make a decent living with medical benefits and a pension plan. We know that people before us sacrificed. People fought long and hard for the right to organize, for the right to have grievances, for the right to get respect, for the right to fair rules and regulations. And I know that's what's motivating you guys. This is not a strike about wages. This is not a strike about what I'm getting out of it. It's a strike about protecting and defending our right to be in a union, and the right to full-time work, and the right to be proud of what we do. We are the trucking industry. The handful of people that run the show don't drive the trucks. They don't go out and sweat. They don't go out and run the rigs. They don't do the highly specialized work that every one of you guys do. This is a demanding job. When you get older in this industry, you show it because of the work and the labor that's required. You guys have done a fabulous job, and it's been true all across this country. Ron Carey has done the right thing. The union has done the right thing. All we're asking for is come back to the table and negotiate. That's all we want. That's all we want. We aren't asking for big things. We're simply saying that, hell, if this union is reduced to part-time workers, we all know what the future is going to be. It's going to be half the workers living on nothing, coming and going, half the workforce under 25, and the rest of us is simply going to wither away. There's plenty of money in the trucking companies. They don't got to spend it buying non-union carriers. They can spend it on themselves. This industry is locked up tighter than a drum. Their stuff is sitting in their facilities. It's not moving. They're losing money every day. If we hold the line, we can win this strike, and we know it. We'll win this strike.
Always tell a teamster by the certain pride he wears. Meeting all challenges, night is spent on. Proud to be a teamster, that's why we're not.
I work for Hoffa right on down through McCarthy, as most of you know.
Walter Shea. Before he became chairman of the Eastern Conference of Teamsters, he was charged with racketeering by the U.S. Department of Justice. Chief of staff for General President Frank Fitzsimmons when he was found by the government to have helped funnel millions of dollars in members' pension funds to mob interests. Chief of staff for General President Roy Williams, who admitted in federal court that he was controlled by the mob. Chief of staff for General President Jackie Presser, who was indicted for embezzlement and racketeering. Walter Shea has never been elected by the members to any union position and has never worked a day in a Teamster craft. He ran for general president in 1991 and was rejected by the membership. He left the International and went to the Eastern Conference, taking with him more than $1 million in pension money for himself.
But I'm criticized because my dad was a Teamster. Should I be embarrassed about that?
Billy Hogan Jr. ran for International Vice President in 1991 and was rejected by the members. He then became chairman of the Central Conference without a vote of the membership. He made nearly $240,000 in Teamster salaries in 1993. Hogan inherited local union office from his father. Hogan's brother is also on the payroll, and so is his son. Hogan told the Chicago Tribune, "We were born to do the job. Whether somebody else likes us doesn't matter."
Give us your prayers, give us your backing, and give us your support.
Mike Riley ran for International Vice President in 1991 and was rejected by the members. He then became chairman of the Western Conference without a vote of the membership. Between the conference, joint council, and local, Teamster members paid Riley more than $300,000 in 1993. Each year, Teamster members put more than $50,000 into Riley's retirement accounts, more than 10 times the money that a company like UPS contributes for a member's retirement.
I appreciate seeing all y'all out here today because you're real true teachers, and that's what I am.
Jerry Cook ran for International Vice President in 1991 and was rejected by the members. He then became chairman of the Southern Conference without a vote of the membership. Cook also was co-owner of a restaurant where conference employees ate lunch. The conference used members' dues money to pay for the lunches, and the money went into the pockets of Cook and his co-owners. Cook held conference meetings in luxury golf resorts at the members' expense.
Conferences were established many, many years ago by people who had foresight and vision.
Anthony Rumore, member of the Eastern Conference Policy Committee. His father was also a Teamster official until he had to resign when the government charged that he was in La Casa Nostra.
We are going to march to the 96th convention and we're going to take care of this problem and throw this damn bomb out.
R.V. Durham ran for general president in 1991 and was rejected by the members, then sat on the Eastern Conference Policy Committee. A longtime supporter of corrupt general presidents, he was rewarded with appointments to international union jobs by Frank Fitzsimmons, Jackie Presser, and Billy McCarthy.
I tell you, today we operate on the old theory of take names and kick ass, and we're going to continue to take names and kick ass in Dallas, Texas.
T.C. Stone ran for international vice president in 1991 and was rejected by the members. He collects three Teamster salaries. Seen enough of these guys? So have Ron Carey and the General Executive Board. Carey and the board voted to eliminate the four U.S. area conferences that cost Teamster members $15 million in dues each year. The area conferences served little function except to provide extra salaries and pensions for a few union officers. For example, 24 officials who already received salaries from locals and joint councils received $500,000 in extra salaries from the Central Conference in 1993. Larry Brennan, who holds at least two other union jobs, got an extra salary as Central Conference Warehouse Director. Brennan ran for International Vice President in 1991 and was voted down by the members. When the recent freight strike began, Brennan undercut the union by immediately predicting through his spokesman to the news media that many Teamsters would cross the picket lines. Jack Mogelson, who also draws at least two other Teamster salaries, got an extra salary as Central Conference Political Director. Mogelson has led the fight at past Teamster conventions to maintain outrageous multiple salaries, allow union officials to sign sweetheart contracts, and prevent members from voting on all contracts that apply to them. In all, extra salaries paid to union officials by the Central Conference were four times higher in 1993 than they were 4 years earlier. Chuck Mack ran for International Vice President in 1991 and was rejected by the membership. He still sat on the Western Conference Policy Committee. When Ron Carey eliminated the past practice of paying extra international union salaries to local officials like Mack as political rewards, the conferences took up the slack. The Western Conference created a new title called Trade Division Coordinator, which replaced for Chuck Mack an extra $30,000 he used to get from the International. That conference salary was in addition to the big salaries Mack draws as head of a local union and joint council.
We're here to protest dictatorship.
Sergio Ponce, head of a local union with 132 members. He was paid more than $100,000 per year in extra salary and expenses as a Southern Conference organizer. Collected expense money of $130 per day for being away from home for more than 250 days a year when he actually was at his home local. The fat cats are angry that they're losing their extra salaries and pensions, and they're fighting back the only way they know how, with lies and scare tactics. So let's get a few things straight. Eliminating the conferences will not affect the autonomy of the local unions or joint councils. It will not affect the pension of any working or retired Teamster. It will not jeopardize existing contracts, grievance rights, or membership services that ought to be preserved through other means. What eliminating the conferences will do is make this union stronger and more democratic. The union is all we have to fight for a better future for our families and for all working people. We're making history by moving the fat cats out and marching together down the road to reform.
us on the job. From Atlanta to Calgary, Vancouver to Cape Cod.
When we had a problem with UPS and they said, any UPS driver, if you're a woman or if you're a man, you can handle a 150-pound package. Well, we disagreed with that position. We felt that our members should be safeguarded, that they should have the kinds of things that are important for them. As a result, the company was going to institute it, and they did, and we struck them for one day. Let me tell you that the only local union who stood up for the members, who stood up for their safety, who stood up for their future, for their families, was Local 413, and I want to thank you for that.